We have to listen to one whole week of Brady is washed, Brady is done, Brady's over the cliff. This is why the Patriots got rid of him. It's the same old Bucks. They're not going to win any games. He's going to throw a million picks. He's too old. And what happened? The Tampa Bay Buccaneers defeated the Carolina Panthers 31-17. It was a lot closer than the score looked, but a win is a win. There's a lot of things that were positive and improved on from last week. And there's, of course, more room to improve moving forward. But I just want to hear what the narrative is going to be now on all the sports talk shows and analysts and radio things, because they spent the whole week killing Brady, killing Bruce Arians for calling Brady out in the press conference. There's tension in the locker room, all these issues, and here we go. Brady looked how he's been looking, a good quarterback, a great quarterback, was able to lead the team down when we needed it, change calls on the line and all of that. And now, what's the narrative going to be? You know, like, everybody was overreacting to the Saints loss, who was probably the best team that we're going to play for the first 2 months of the season, probably. Maybe compared to maybe Green Bay, but literally, it's overreaction week. But let me get into my actual reaction to this game. I am Ramy B. If you are new here, make sure you click the subscribe button down below to stay tuned to my weekly Buccaneer game reaction videos. Yes, I'm wearing a Jameis Winston jersey. I wanted to match the white jerseys that we were wearing today, and unfortunately, my Brady jersey still has not come in after three, going into 4 months now. So I need the Buccaneer shop to send it over so I can start wearing it for my games. But anyways, like I said, there's a lot of good things to improve on. If I look over to the side, I'm looking at my laptop screen so I can read some stats and things like that. Brady was 23 of 35 for 217, one touchdown, one interception, and one fumble. The fumble looked more like Ronald Jones' fault. His elbow was high, hit the ball. But, you know, they accredit that to the quarterback. The pick was not a good throw at all. He was rushed. I understand that. I don't think Brady played that bad at all. I believe he should have had over 300 yards and three touchdowns. As we know, there was a lot of drop balls, a lot of catchable drop balls. They weren't even, like, really contested. That Grayson one up the left sideline where he, like, tried catching it like this and it bounced off his helmet. Completely unacceptable. I said last week, we have so many weapons on offense. Why are we throwing it to these dudes that nobody's really talked about? I don't think Grayson gets another ball thrown at him again this whole season. Brady's all about trust. And if you saw Brady after that, he was literally on the side going, like, are you f***ing kidding me? And then the LeSean McCoy drop in the fourth. Was it the fourth quarter? Before we kicked that field goal, hit him literally right in the hands. He was open. Would have been another touchdown. You throw in those two, we're over 300 yards easily. The Grayson one would have been a 50-ish yard touchdown. The LeSean McCoy about 15. You throw that on, and then he had the couple defensive pass interferences to Gronk and Scotty Miller. So Brady played a solid game, even with the one pick. Again, there's still some things he needs to learn with the offense to be on the same page. It takes time. Luckily, we didn't have another really solid team that we were playing today. And we could afford to make some mistakes. Leonard Fournette, 12 rushes for 103 yards, two touchdowns, 8.6 yards per carry. This is exactly why I was happy for Fournette to be signed. And I think next week he's going to get a lot more carries, but I believe by week five the latest, he's going to be our primary back. Ronald Jones, 7 for 23, one touchdown. Ronald Jones can make more out of, like, when the line is being pushed back, he's a little shiftier than Fournette, which I like, but Fournette is the one that has the bigger, big play capability. When it comes to pass catching, it seems Ronald Jones is doing better. Fournette is getting hit behind the line a lot. But Fournette, in that fourth quarter, the drive that we led to the field goal, he rushed a 25-yarder, an 8-yarder. He got like 40, 50 yards on that drive alone. He's the punisher. He's the big bruiser on offense that's going to close out the game for us. And then, obviously, after the onside kick that Gronk recovered, Fournette broke a 48-yarder, I believe, touchdown. And that's literally what we signed him for. He's going to wear down the defense. And I'm happy for him. I think now he's starting to get his feet under him, and he's starting to understand the offense a little bit more. Like I said, two more weeks, he's going to be the primary back. There's no reason he shouldn't be the primary back. Once Chris Godwin comes back and our offense is back to, like, full health, last week Evans had the hamstring thing he was recovering from. Once Godwin is back, our offense is going to be at full capability, and then the box is not going to be as packed as much. I'm going into the receivers. Mike Evans played a hell of a game, seven catches, 104 yards, and one touchdown. Couldn't have asked for more from him considering Godwin was out. Justin Watson, 2 for 48. He was our second leading receiver. Nobody else had over 30 yards. Scotty Miller was disappointing. The offense overall, like when you think of, like, the passing game, did not do that well. They played a okay game, but I think it was the defense of the Bucs that really, really carried the team today. But the offense, when we needed them, they did their job. I believe the Bucs defense was on the field for 35, 36 minutes. So they were pretty gassed, and the fact that they were able to get stops when needed was very impressive. Lavonte David had one forced fumble, and he recovered it. I think now he's like the team leader in forced fumbles or recoveries. I think he passed Derrick Brooks or something like that. Winfield had that forced fumble early in the first quarter as well. Whitehead had that beautiful pick, that diving pick. And Carlton Davis, I've been saying Carlton Davis is elite. I read a thing that in the last five games before this week, we played Julio, DeAndre Hopkins, Michael Thomas, and we played Detroit. I don't know if they have really a big elite receiver. Galladay, maybe? But he held all five of them to total of 17 catches or something like that for 190 yards, which is like 40 yards per game. I think he's elite, but I think he's not going to get the credit he deserves until he starts getting interceptions. And today he got one that was really needed because the Panthers were driving down to tie the game, and he got a beautiful pick. It was a bad throw, of course, but still, if the bad throws come, you still got to pick them off. That was great. Devin White, 11 tackles. I read that he is the first. This is his first back-to-back 10-plus tackles in his career, and the last time it happened for the Bucs was 2018 when Lavonte had three games of that. Can't say much more about Devin White. He has been elite since he came back from his injury and kind of got the hang of the game. He is going to be a legitimate threat in the NFL for the rest of his career if he stays healthy. He is going to be potential defensive player of year candidates multiple times. I'm not going to say he's Luke Kuechly yet, but he has the potential to be really a game wrecker. Ndamukong Suh, 2 sacks. I know last year I think he had 3 or 4 the whole season, and people were saying, you know, he's not getting sacks, and that's not what they're asking him for. They're asking him and Vea to block up, clog up the running lanes up the middle. But 2 sacks, impressive. Jason Pierre-Paul, another sack. I think that puts him at like over 20-something in his career in Tampa. Shaq Barrett, 0 sacks. 2 games now, 0 sacks. I think teams are figuring out how to adjust to him, and because he had the breakout year last year, I'm not going to say he's a bust. I'm going to say that now he has to learn to adjust to the defenses adjusting to him. Last season, he did get stopped a little bit, and then when Jason Pierre-Paul came back, he ended up dominating again. But the things that don't show up on the stat sheet is the QB pressures. He got a lot of QB pressures, he rushed Teddy Bridgewater a lot. There was that one play I remember in the red zone where Bridgewater had to throw it away before he stepped out of bounds. So I'm not going to get too hard on Shaq Barrett. Now, flipping to Carolina, yes, Bridgewater had 33 completions for 367 yards. A lot of it, they were just airing it out once McCaffrey got hurt. Some garbage time, we were playing prevent defense. That's going to happen with prevent defense. The other team's going to get a lot of yards. He did have 2 interceptions, no touchdowns. Didn't look like he had even close to a touchdown at all. So I think we played a pretty good game on him, considering he doesn't turn the ball over a lot in his career generally. Getting 2 picks on him is great. I know a lot of analysts were saying, you know, I don't know if they can get turnovers on Bridgewater. Well, we got it. McCaffrey had 2 touchdowns, but similar to last week with Kamara, 18 rushes, 59 yards. He's not getting a lot of the rushes that he's used to, a lot of the yards, but when he is inside the red zone, he's always a threat, and he's going to get those touchdowns. Now, for the receivers, we did give up 200-yard receivers. DJ Moore had 8 catches for 120, and Robbie Anderson had 9 for 109. Again, like I said, a lot of it was garbage time, prevent defense. We were playing off the receivers a lot and allowing them to get deep balls. Which kind of put him back in the game. I think the flow of the game was similar to last week. We played dominant first quarter. We started slipping a little bit. Well, we were dominant in the second quarter. I don't think we put up any points in the second quarter. No, we did. We put up. We were 21-0 at halftime. And then the third quarter, we kind of let him get back into it. I think the play calling can be improved. Once we're going up again, we're trying to run down the clock. We're trying to rush the ball a lot. First, second down, very predictable. And then we're getting put in third and long situations. A lot of times, third and 10-plus yards. And I think that's something that needs to get figured out with personnel and play calls. Obviously, with Brady being there, they're trying to figure things out. But I don't think when we start playing above average and elite teams that we can keep doing that. So I think that needs to improve. Brady, I can see, was frustrated with a lot of the drop passes, as he should be. And you could see him on the sideline, you know, yelling at players a bit. But like I said, once Godwin comes back, he's the most reliable hands on our team. So we'll be fine with that. And Evans is obviously Evans. It's disappointing to see Gronk isn't really catching as many balls. That pass interference, yes, it was a pass interference, but it hit his hand and he should have caught that. I don't think he's back to where he was before, but in my video I made when we signed him way back in the spring, I said that I think he's going to start off slow and we're not going to utilize him a lot, but once he gets back into the rhythm of playing football and the groove, once we get down into the December games, late November, he's going to start being a bigger factor, and we're going to need him to, so he can start dominating. He's pretty clutch. So overall, I'd give this game a B, maybe a B+. Defense played great considering they're on the field a lot. Offense played well enough to win the game. And, you know, even though we did give up the 21-0 lead and made it a 14-24 game and then 17-24, what you want from your offense is, even if they do kind of give up the game a little bit, that they can score when it's needed. And boy, we did it with Fournette. He broke that run. So, solid performance. Great, great recovery. Great bounce back from last week. Now, next week, we go to Denver. Denver played the Steelers pretty tough, I think, in Pittsburgh. It was a 5-point game, I want to say. I know Drew Locke was hurt and their backup came in and played pretty well. It's going to be a tough game. Playing in Denver in that high altitude is very tough and difficult. And Brady has historically struggled in Denver. But I think that is a winnable game, especially if Chris Godwin is back. I would like to see us throw a little bit more on first and second down, or use play action a lot more on first, second down. So as we always like to run it with Ronald Jones to the left side of the offensive line. And we need to run some play actions and make them play on their feet a little bit, make the linebackers hesitate a little bit before deciding to come in and stop the rush. That way we can open it up for the rest of the team. But yeah, Bucs Nation, comment down below. What did you think of Fournette's performance? I know this is what we expected from him, but did you think it would come this way? And like I said, make sure you subscribe. 1-1 on the season. Hopefully we're going to be 2-1 next week. And I think we're going to go 2-1. No, I think I predicted we're going to lose to Denver when I did my prediction. I don't know. I don't remember what I predicted back in like May. But yeah, I think seeing the game, I think it's a winnable game. And yeah, make sure you subscribe. I appreciate it. Let's f-ing go, Tampa. This is what we wanted from Brady. So yeah, thank you for tuning in. And as always, I am out. Our offense tough, our defense rough. Go Bucks, go Bucks. Ain't no other team stopping us. Go Bucks, go Bucks.